Welcome. We're going to talk about digital realities now. And this kind of goes to the next scape of what do we define as reality and how are we redefining what we think of as reality. So let's kind of go right into the deep end as we go. So what I really propose here is there's a spectrum of discrete realities that we're creating with our digital prowess. There's lots of arguments as to whether we should, whether we shouldn't. But the fact is, this is what's happening. So it bears in mind that we should be able to describe it in some cohesive way. So reality, as we typically have known it, is what we see here on the left side of the presentation. So reality is what we've come to know as our perceptions and what we do with our own bodies, interacting with the world around us and the universe around us, and how that becomes cohesive between each other. Our reality coexists between multiple people, between multiple animals, plants, all those types of things. So that's kind of what we talk about as reality. People have some debates about, you know, what about dreams? Is that real? Or are those just perceptions? So that's a whole nother conversation. However, all of that is put into the realm of what we call the real. Now people argue over time, and philosophers have argued for years as to, okay, well, what actually is reality? That's for a philosophy class. But now I want to move into, what are we creating now? Now we've created several different types of things. The first we'll talk about is augmented reality, and this is where we're superimposing some digital constructs onto our reality so that we can interact with them in the space around us. There's also virtual reality, which is removing us from the space around us. So that we're looking into completely a virtual world and then interacting with that virtual world. That's a little different. And there's something newer called immersive reality. And immersive reality is where we're blending these two again. However, we're giving emphasis on the virtual piece around us, even though we're interacting with things in the real world as well that help accentuate the virtual experience. So there's like different sides. So if you think of augmented reality as really reality with a touch of virtual reality or digital reality, and immersive reality is virtual reality with a touch of real reality. So it's kind of an interesting concept to think about. We'll look at all that. And when we're really going to probably be, whether you want to call it successful or dismal, is when we can't really tell the difference between an immersive reality and actual reality. If we get to a non-distinction event, then what? So that's more for ethical arguments and things like that. But taking that into consideration, that is what the goal is of a lot of these groups that are trying to create immersive environments. Okay, so let's talk about the first one, augmented reality. This actually has lots of different applications. It can be extremely helpful to humanity in lots of different ways. You've probably seen examples of this, for example, with the HoloLens from Microsoft. Google Glass tried to make an inroad into that. Didn't work out so well with that first user interface, but they've been trying to make iterations on that. Here you can have people helping people where they can communicate and kind of show people how to do things. So they're actually looking at how to repair stuff or how to troubleshoot things. Or even in medicine, on here's the plan of approach and we have the patient right there. So we want to make sure that we're looking exactly at what we want, where we can superimpose maybe some imaging that we have done previously on the patient onto the patient, so we know where we're going to make less mistakes and less errors, help improve outcomes. And also museums are already using these things where they're linking up famous paintings and things with information and audio descriptions about the paintings, about the art through Wikipedia and things like that. So that's really kind of some great uses when you look at that. So in essence, what are we doing is we're positioning digital media, data, and or the experience around the observer in the space that you're standing in or walking in. Includes visual, auditory, haptic is on the verge where they're really making inroads in research. Olfactory, still more in research. You see some of that in parks. Disney likes to do some things where they add smells or heat, somatosensory systems where you can add wind, things like that. Hardware, software integrated systems is the requirement. For the most part right now, most things have been put on as like goggles that are kind of like glasses that you wear, so that you can actually see through them to see the world around you, but they're superpositioning almost like a HUD type technology on top of there, which is like a heads-up display is where some of that came from, where it looks like a hologram in front of you. Now they're doing research into trying to make contact lens versions of these so you don't have these bulky types of glasses on there. But that's still in the research phases. Different applications, we've mentioned a lot of these. There's probably even more than that. Also distributed music concerts. If you think about it, you could be standing there and there's like a rock band right there playing in your backyard. And you're watching and rocking out along with a million of your friends all around the world. Really cool type of ideas like that. So moving from augmented reality, let's now take a look at what virtual reality is. So virtual reality, just as you see here, it's more of a blocking out of reality and generating a complete virtual version of reality for you to interact with. So it's really an escapist type technology, similar to video games, but now then you can escape into that reality. So the user experience is wholly based on this virtual information where you're really cut off from the real world. And again, there's a lot of ethical arguments on that. It's like, is that a good thing? Is that a bad thing? Are you going to have a whole bunch of people addicted to this? How's that going to affect people emotionally, psychologically? Should kids be doing this? Is it going to adversely develop their brain? So there's a lot of concerns that go along with all these types of things. Lots of different hardware and software. Again, it's an integrated system with both, except in this case, the technology on is a head mounts display that blocks out everything. They'll even put in sound so it blocks out all the sound as well. So you can have even helmets for these types of things. Haptic gloves, these are things which give you vibrations and or similar to pressure responses. They're also working on suits for the same kind of thing. Other somatosensory, olfactory temperatures in research. It's very difficult to, in a portable way, create different smells unless you had some kind of chemical way of doing that. We're not there yet. Software development kits, so SDKs, are available for things like the Oculus platform and several other platforms that are working. So the applications thus far really have been video games, really probably the number one. Traumatic experience. Oh, actually, this is a different statement I said. One of the things that they have to be careful of with these types of systems is that people have a much harder time differentiating themselves from the experience and their own personal well-being. Versus, so let's say we take a video game that's like a first-person shooter video game. Kids, people understand it's a video game and it's out there and it's not really encompassing or affecting their body. So their body doesn't have the fight or flight mechanisms that would engage. Studies have shown when you start putting people in a 3D environment, in a virtual environment, and you put some of these stressors on them, people have a really hard time with it, and they actually can have stress-induced trauma experiences. So that's something then you got to be really careful, or you're not going to make something like a horror film that somebody's immersed in, and then they are traumatically affected and can't get that out of their mind. So there's a lot of stuff that they have to be careful of in this world, even in the entertainment world, where you're going to have that, because you could have an immersive movie that you're walking around and then the events are happening around you. Again, you got to be cognizant of how's that really going to affect the body. We don't really know all the effects yet. Virtual meetings, some more positive type of development where you can have a meeting with your colleagues that are virtually across the world. And it's like you're talking in the same room. Virtual training and education, again, it's another positive inroad where you could make use of this type of technology. So let's talk about immersive reality. So immersive reality is a little bit different in that you're blending a lot more of the surroundings so that you have mobility. Most virtual reality right now is you don't have a lot of mobility. You're limited to a certain area, such as you see here where they have a shooter that's in a halo here. Now the idea is that you could move anywhere you want, and it's a completely virtual system. However, immersive reality is making use of the environment around you. So it's really an augmented virtual reality with real environments. Lets you be more mobile. You can have physical interactions. You can have multiple people having experiences at the same time. It is hardware, software, and facility. So there's actually a third factor in here. So you have a wearable computational system for each user, or something equivalent to that, allows users to move freely, relatively freely. You can touch, feel objects, move through doors, open portals. You can feel, they can add the feeling of heat, wind, cold, smells and scents in certain areas, all those types of things. So a good example of this is Hyperspace XR's Wonderfall. It's called A Tale of Two Realms. So this is a pilot that they've been doing up in Seattle at the Pacific Science Center. And it's had a lot of fanfare and a lot of different people have gone through it. And they've been testing out the system so that they can go bigger and better and eventually try to go into parks such as like Disneyland or things like that. So I'm going to show you a couple of videos on that so you can really get a sense of what's going on and kind of just how cool it is.
It was like I stepped into another world.
Not only you're seeing the world around you and interacting with it, you're actually feeling the vibrations of the things and you can hear the sounds.
It was unbelievable. I mean, I'm not even a gamer and I was blown away.
We feel like you can only be so immersed in your living room. So we wanted people to step through that fourth wall and traverse out across bigger areas so you actually feel like you've been transported to another realm.
It's really neat to be able to work with a team of engineers and discuss how things are going to be implemented. But the exciting part of it to me is it's also a newer, fresh explorer territory. So we have a lot of freedom, in a sense, to really push boundaries, to see new ways of storytelling.
Being inside an RPG game, and you feel like you're doing everything, you're walking around it. It's not just you're playing around with your console anymore.
Being able to grab onto all the different little things, like the planets and the dragon jumped out of the book. Yeah.
At Hyperspace, our SDK incorporates the entire environmental setup. Developers can easily incorporate experiences with wind and temperature changes and rumble. We're opening up extended reality to anyone who wants to make it, to bring to any venue that wants to share it with the public.
This was the funnest thing I have ever done. I wasn't sure at all what to expect, but it was so much fun.
I absolutely loved it, and I was fully into it. I thought I was there. I thought it was amazing.
Where we see this going is entertainment or edutainment type locations. And I'm excited to build experiences that you can't right now through a video or through those kind of mediums. You can take someone somewhere and allow them to soak something in by physically being there.